Welcome to the Zelda Informer podcast. I am your host, Alfred Tabax, joined today by three different people. Well, one of them is the same person. The other two are a bit new. So first, of course, we've got the podcast co-host, Nate.
Yeah, I'm a different person because I missed 1 week. Come on now.
Yeah, I said you're the same person. you're one of the same people. And then we have two, one of them is returning, kind of. Daniel's been with us before. Say hi, Daniel.
Hello, Daniel.
There you go. And then we have a new guest on tonight, who is, or today, whenever you're listening to this, who's one of our news writers. Say hello to Andy.
Hello, everybody.
So this week, I was thinking about, kind of just about this year and some things that I wanted to go over, just talk about. And before we get into that, someone was, on our Facebook page, someone brought up a fan topic that I wanted to talk about. This is kind of something we talked about last week, or the week before, when Nate and I went over that huge topic. This one was about, a couple of them actually were about returning items such as like the fire rod, or maybe returning races, or masks in the Zelda games, like in Majora's Mask. And so I was kind of wondering what you guys' opinions on that were. Like, for example, do you think Breath of the Wild should have some old items returning, such as fire rods or stuff, or more dramatic mechanics such as transformation masks or masks in general? What are your guys' opinions on that one?
Well, we already have seen that the fire rod, which was the example you said, is in the game. Mm-hmm. Although it's breakable, so it's not a permanent item like we've seen before in Zelda games. But even if we get these temporary items that are breakable, I'd love to see more Zelda items. If you could find a hookshot or claw shot, even if it's breakable or it wears down over time, I'd love to see that, especially with the physics that Breath of the Wild has. The things that you could do with these kind of items would be really cool.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think that we're going to see all like the Zelda staples back, right? Like the claw shot, the bombs, etc., etc. The coolest part of a new Zelda game for me is seeing what the new items are and what they're going to do in the world around you. So I would lean a little bit more towards, I'd like to see some newer stuff. I mean, obviously we're not going to get, you know, Rock's Cape or anything like that. Let's see what new items there are and see, hopefully they can use them in multiple shrines. A little problem before was that you'd get an item and just be specific to a dungeon, not much use after that. So I'm pretty excited to see where they go with that.
How about you, Nate?
I think the only thing I like about returning items is seeing what new ways those items are going to be used. You know, as we've seen with the fire rod, you know, we've seen fire rods in the past where, you know, it spits flames out or it throws a fireball. Even in, like, A Link Between Worlds, I think it's split into three fireballs and even, like, grass on fire, which is all great. But, like, in Breath of the Wild, the fireball bounces around and has, like, a special spin attack version that throws out a bunch of them. And because of the physics, it bounces everywhere. The wind affects it. So it's really interesting to me to see how they take what these items have done in the past and do something new with them. And I think we already know that there's a lightning rod in the game. We just haven't seen it be used. It's really interesting. I'm a person that I always like having new items because then I don't know what to expect with them. Mm-hmm. Whereas you get a fire rod, I kind of expect what that thing's going to do. Whereas with new items, I don't always know. But, you know, there's a lot of old items I think see come back. Like, I think transformation masks, as an example, is something that could easily come back.
Mm-hmm. Especially in the context of the open world in this game. I think that'd be a really clever addition.
Yeah, like, there's just so many different ways that they could incorporate some of those older items. I mean, I'm not against new items coming back. I just want to see what new things are going to do with them to make it not feel exactly the same as it used to be.
Well, and you know, the thing, too, back in Twilight Princess was they kind of took the hook shot and almost turned you into Spider-Man with it, too, right? Like, by giving you the claw shot. So what was old was new again. So even if they put a twist on something like that, that'd be really cool.
And I was thinking about this too. It kind of in reference to masks, or even like the Ocarina of Time, or something like that. It would be cool to see a callback to that. The the main focus of those items was the core of the game. Like, they were made, and the game was kind of made around them. And so, I don't know how it would be, or how it would look, or how it would feel to see them in a lesser role, kind of in just like a, oh yeah, well, there's the ocarina now, you just use it once or twice. I mean, the reason why those were so popular, the reason why those made an impact, was because the game was specifically tailored around them. Like, Majora's Mask was all, like, the masks were everything in that game.
Oh, the Dwarven Centurion guys. Was
everything in Ocarina of Time. This is the Wind Waker, Twilight Princess mechanics. Like, they're all built around a specific mechanic. And so bigger items like that, that have more of an impact on gameplay, I don't know if we're going to see in Breath of the Wild. That would be cool. But I just don't know if Nintendo would throw in, you know, transformation masks. Whereas, like, fire rods, ice rods, lightning rods, stuff like that, that's more of a weapon as opposed to, like, a completely new gameplay mechanic. But that's just kind of my, where I fall in. Like, no, I'm not saying I wouldn't like to see them back in it, but realistically, that's kind of what I'm thinking for that.
As long as it can serve a greater purpose other than maybe a one and done shrine, then I'm all for having those items in. But if it's gonna be one of those things that's just in there for the sake of being it in there, then yeah, I think we can move on to something new. Is what I'm thinking.
Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to have a little talk about Zelda at the beginning of this because this is Zelda Informer podcast. And while there has been some news trickling out, it's not a lot of significant stuff unless Nate wants to call me out on that.
New enemy!
What?
New enemy in Breath of the Wild.
Yeah, there's a new enemy in Breath of the Wild. It looks like one of the...
Looks badass.
Smaller guardians, too.
Yeah, it looks like one of those mini guardians from the shrines, but, like, a more badass
version. It's just because I've been playing awesome. Skyrim, but it reminded me of that little dwarven sphere that attacks you in Skyrim. Yeah, that guy.
Yeah, I saw that. It looked pretty cool. I didn't get to read the article yet, though. Sorry, Nate.
Well, there isn't really anything to read about it. It's just a screenshot. Yeah.
So, kind of transitioning then to the Switch. That's probably what a lot of this is going to be on. It's just Nintendo General on the Switch. There's this kind of a topic that we kind of talked about. We talked about the Virtual Console a while back. But reports have been coming out that the Switch, Nintendo Switch, is going to have a... There were quotes around this, so quote-unquote disappointing Virtual Console at launch. And I kind of wanted to know what your guys' thoughts on that were. Like, do you think Nintendo needs to have a strong Virtual Console at launch, or what's the deal with that?
No.
go ahead, sorry.
No, it's okay. I don't have a lot to say on this except that Nintendo's never had a strong Virtual Console at launch. So it's kind of one of those that I don't think anyone buys these systems for the Virtual Console. I think it's just a bonus. So I think it's one of those that if this was a continuing of architecture, like Nintendo was keeping the same like kind of hardware going forward and just beefing it up, I would expect a strong Virtual Console launch because it should just carry over the entire Virtual Console from Wii U. But since they're basically hitting the reset button, hopefully for the last time, I definitely don't expect them to have a strong launch, nor do I think it's that important. I think Switch 2, or whatever the next thing is after the Switch, that will be important to carry over whatever the Switch has for a VC. But right now, I honestly don't see that as being a make or break. As long as, this is kind of the caveat that Wii U did allow, you're able to maybe sort of like attach the games that you have on your Wii U to an account, so when those games do release on the Switch, you can just download them. You don't have to repurchase them.
Nailed it.
But again, they didn't even do that on the Wii U. Like on the Wii U, when they released them for the Wii U, you had to, even if you had the game on the Wii, you still had to pay a small fee. So yeah, I don't know. At launch, I don't think it's that important, but I think it is important how they treat their Wii U customers when it comes to the Virtual Console.
Well, I mean, here's my thing, is define disappointing. right? Like, disappointing to me is going to be launching with all of the same, like three Super Mario Bros. Titles, the same Zelda, the same Metroid that they launched with before. It's going to be launching with all the games that were just on the NES Classic. It's going to be it's going to be basically carrying forward and rebuying all the games that I bought on my Wii Virtual Console and then my Wii U Virtual Console, right? So, to me, a non-disappointing launch is, hey, here's Super Mario Sunshine or something like that, right? So it's something a little bit new. So, if it's just the same game, rebuying it again and again and again, yeah, it's disappointing. But I don't think that's a make or break thing for me, and I'm sure it's not for a lot of people either.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, they've mentioned before, or at least I think there's rumors flying about that there is supposed to be GameCube Virtual Console coming to the Switch, but yeah, I think I'm on the same page. I think that people are going to buy the Switch for Switch games, and for the Switch, the idea of the Switch itself, which is its portability. I can't picture anyone thinking, like, I'm going to go buy a Nintendo Switch so I can download Super Mario Bros. 3.
Right?
You know? I don't, and if they can after they buy it, like Nate said, that's just a mm-hmm. bonus, you know. But I think that the Switch has to have a strong lineup of its own. It can't rely on Virtual Console to sell it. That's not the selling point of the system.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking, is that the Virtual Console lineup doesn't really have to make as much of an impact as the actual starting lineup for the console itself. So it can have a great, like, it can literally have a completely full Virtual Console lineup. But if it doesn't have good, you know, first day games, then it's not going to be a big hit because, you know, like you said, we've already bought Super Mario Bros. And Super Mario 64, and unless it has like 15 GameCube games coming out on the Switch straight up for like Virtual Console day one, then I don't really know.
Because, I mean, let's be honest. Most of the greatest Nintendo games are already on the Virtual Console as it is right now, for the exception of GameCube games, right? So they can have every great game that they've ever had, and that's still going to be. If I was buying just for that, I wouldn't spend, you know, X amount of $100 on that just to buy the same Virtual Console games. But I mean, you guys are right. Like, I didn't buy a 3DS to play, you know, Link's Awakening, right? I bought it to play the new stuff coming out. So.
Yeah, and I think that that's the important thing to think about when they're talking about the disappointing Virtual Console, is that it's, you know, that's, like Nate said, it's a secondary thing, it's a bonus, it's not really what pushes consoles. Like, Nintendo doesn't put those up there and go through the time to port them over onto the Switch to make millions and millions of dollars. They're mostly a secondary thing. I guess you could say they're for fans.
And I kind of put it out there that I don't know. At least personally, I don't know when the Virtual Console hasn't been overall disappointing. like, when they announced this idea with the Wii, it's cool, it's new, like, whatever. But then they started trickling games out so slow.
Mm-hmm. Well, but they also had WiiWare for that.
They did, but it was just so slow. And then they did the exact same thing with the Wii U. And it almost feels like if that's how they do it with the Switch, it's like they're not learning anything.
Nintendo can be pretty stubborn in that way, to be fair.
Yeah, they can be, and they shouldn't. Like, if they were able to sit there and put together 30 of the best NES games into an NES Classic with awesome emulation and everything, like, you know, pretty quickly, why can't they just, like, package a whole bunch of games and release them at once on the Switch that have good emulation and all that, instead of having to be like, yeah, we're releasing, like, 20 games a year, and only 5 of them you care about.
Well, now here's a question for you guys too: is it possible we see a decline of Virtual Console and maybe a rise in, let's say they put together a Super Nintendo Classic or a NES Classic 2 or something like that? Like, what do you guys think of that?
Well, I don't know if
if they gave a Super Nintendo Classic, right? I'd go nuts.
Well, I don't know if
I'd love it.
And there's actually I saw some news today that kind of supports there might be a Super Nintendo Classic.
Take my money.
They filed a patent for a Super Nintendo controller.
But I don't think Nintendo would go out of the way to stop Virtual Console.
No, I don't think they view it as the same market.
Well, also, like, getting a NES Classic right now is almost impossible. I've been trying to get one since they came out. I didn't pre-order one or anything.
Could you?
But they're for, I don't know, they're probably sold out when I was trying to pre-order them. But at Walmart right now, the base price for one is $250. And that's at retail. I don't know if I've ever seen a retail price go up like that because of demand. And again, like we've talked about, you know, you just said Nintendo hasn't learned from their past in terms of certain things. It's the same thing. Like that, who didn't think that something like this would be popular? Who was like, no, only like again, 2 or 3 people are going to want one.
And I wrote an editorial about this over at Nintendo Prime about the Classic. And, like, Nintendo, I don't know. They're either really stupid, which it's very easy to see how they're really stupid. Or they just, especially in North America, view this as a viable business plan of not producing enough of something to drive demand to ensure it sells out for years to come.
I just don't get that strategy, demand. Though. Like I wanted one for Christmas, right? And that would have been a perfect thing for, let's say, my girlfriend who doesn't know anything about games, just pick up and buy. And I feel like a lot of people were in the same boat as me. And now that chance is missed because they didn't ship enough. It's just, manufacturing demand is great, but eventually you have to follow through. Sure. On that.
Well, there's also the, like you know, you could be on that side, I was going to buy one for Christmas, couldn't get one, now I'm not going to buy one at all. But then there's also the crowd that are like Jim Sterling, who came out and said, look, I wasn't even interested in this thing, but because it's rare, if I see one on a store shelf, I'm going to buy it.
Mm-hmm.
That, and he would not have bought it if it was in plenty of stock and easy to get. So, like,
well, that's worse then, because the people that do want it.
Well, I know, but that supports Nintendo's theory of create demand by not having as many of them. Because here's someone who wasn't going to buy one.
It's the exact same thing with the Amiibo. Exactly.
Yeah,
like that.
Yeah,
I hate that marketing strategy.
But it worked. It worked. And like that. That's where I see like Nintendo's never going to publicly say that's what they're doing because it's a really shitty thing to do. But clearly, they keep doing it, and it keeps working. So it's like, and it's only in North America. The rest of the world, like Japan, doesn't have this problem. They have too many of the Famicoms. It's so easy to get it in their country. The Famicom Classic Edition, or Famicom Mini, whatever they call it over there. Like, you know, the sales figures even show, like the NES was more popular in the United States. We have over twice the population of Japan, but Japan has like 500,000 units of this thing, and we only got like 200,000, and they didn't even sell out of all their units. So it's like a massive priority thing that they just screwed up, and it's just, like, if they would have released 500,000 units in the United States, they probably would have sold out anyways.
Yeah. But here's the thing that confuses me, is that this was pretty much the only thing that they had going for them this holiday season. There's really nothing else that I could think of that they were trying to push. The Wii U's pretty much being taken off shelves.
I think the only thing that could justify,
but I agree.
Yeah, but that's one game for one console. Like, this is a separate console, $60, 30 games. Like, this is a big thing that you'd think that everyone would want, and everyone does want. But my only hope
in the United States is that the reason the stock is so limited is because when the Switch comes out, you'll be able to, for like $30, get all 30 of those games day one there.
Because
if you get top tier emulation, just like the NES Classic, you also get the dock to play it on your TV and take it with you, and it's cheaper because you don't have to buy a separate system because you already have the Switch. But again, you know, the people who bought the NES Classic then might feel like idiots. Because they paid $60 to get those 30 games. But, you know, I'm just trying to think of, like, how in the world they can make this okay again. Because they never really apologized for the Amiibo thing. They're like, yeah, we'll restock eventually. And they did.
Yeah.
I mean, they did.
I saw it the other day, and I almost fainted. I had to order mine from Japan.
Well, it's the thing. Like, and Amiibo, that's even one of those things. Like, Amiibo are not region-locked. So you can get them from Japan if you want to pay a little extra. Or a lot extra, depending on what retailer you get it from. So, you know, Amiibo, I almost was forgiving because it was still possible to get those rare Amiibo. You just had to import.
Yeah.
NES Classic, you can't because, yes, you could buy the Japanese one. You could buy the European one. But they all have different games. Mm-hmm. So
and languages.
And languages. Yeah, I mean, the European one, you'd be fine with that one. But still, it's just like, I don't know. It's a business strategy I think they do on purpose, but can't ever admit to. So they're always just going to say, we underestimated demand. And the only time I really believe they underestimated demand was with the Wii.
Yeah.
And I think because the Wii was like a happy accident by, you know, because they had been losing popularity. There was like no hype for the thing going into the launch and it blew up. So like, I get it. Like, it's easy to see why they underestimated demand. They had no reason to believe that was a 100 million unit seller. But it was. And so you could forgive them for doing that once. But I think what happened is Nintendo saw the demand for that just stay really, really high for 2 years because it was so hard to get that they're like, hey, why don't we just do this with everything in the United States?
I just think they really missed the boat. Like, they had, I mean, a lot of people that were going to buy the NES Classic were probably older. Some of them might have kids. There's a chance for new fans. And for a lot of people, that's, you were that's only, done now, right?
Like, yeah. It was only going to be people who played NES games that wanted the NES Classic. Yeah.
I just think that was, like, overall, it was a poor... I mean, you could look at it from two ways. You could look at it from as it was good that they created artificial demand because more people want them now. But at the same time,
well, at a consumer level, it's shitty. There's no way I look at it as that's good for me. That's good. Like, no. Well, how many of us
even
here
at a business level?
Do any of us own one?
Nope. No, I don't.
Actually, I do.
Yeah, I don't. I don't. My only hope right now is I submitted an email to Nintendo asking for a review copy, and they told me that they don't even have enough stock to hand out all the review copies. I don't know what Nintendo is doing. It's really weird. And maybe it's just because they got caught in a bad... I mean, I could believe that maybe they're stupid and that they're caught in this situation where they're trying to make NES classics and at the same time they're trying to develop Switch units and they just do not have enough factories to do it. I don't know. They had to have known about this NES Classic thing so long ago to make enough units. And, like, the reason that Japan has so much production compared to the United States where it's selling better, I just don't know what Nintendo's doing with this thing. It doesn't make any sense to me.
I mean, that's pretty much, you know, we never really know what Nintendo's doing.
Like, that's why I said it's got to be on purpose because they've seen it work, so they think it's going to work again. And it probably will. Here we are. Here we are entering January, and you still can't get the thing. Because it's selling out. Literally 3 units of a lot arrived at my local Walmart yesterday. I was there at midnight, and I was like eighth in line to get it.
Yeah. GameStop here had like 3 full restocks at the three different GameStops, and they sold out almost instantly.
So it's working. And that's what sucks about it is I know if they're doing it on purpose, it is working already. And that sucks, because it's going to make Nintendo want to do it again in the future.
Well, I mean, the really crappy thing is, because you guys are in the States, if I'm correct, and I'm in Canada, so we even get your leftovers, so it's even harder to find here, so it's rough.
Oh, yeah. I'm Canadian too, Andy. Yeah,
so basically, it's rough up here. If you ever want something Nintendo at launch, better be lucky enough to get a pre-order in, or you're screwed.
Yeah.
Like, they kept saying, oh, you know, there's been a lot of talk lately about, oh, who cares about pre-orders? It doesn't matter. Things are plentiful. Not if you're a Nintendo fan.
Well, that makes me nervous, too, because I better pre-order the Switch already.
Like,
I can't.
You want a Switch, you better get that pre-order as soon as it opens. They don't have open locally here yet, but I'm assuming that 12th or 13th. So, like, I'm going to have an online and an in-store pre-order just in case one gets canceled. Then I might just hand off one of them. Yeah. Just because of that Best Buy fiasco with Majora's Mask. Oh, my God.
Oh, boy.
If you get both, you have to mail me one.
No. I'm going to hand one off because I can't afford to buy both.
You know, shout out to Best Buy, though. They had a wicked Boxing Day sale. Bought a couple games.
Nice. It's always good.
So, speaking of sales, thank you for that wonderful
segue.
So, Nintendo put up a winter sale before Christmas, and it's still kind of continuing. But it's quite possibly one of the worst sales I've ever seen in my entire life.
I didn't even bother to look at it.
There's not a single first-party game on that list. It's like the most recognizable one. Was a Monster Hunter game.
What is the... what? Let me see this. Winter...
It was like a bunch of Lego games or something like that, wasn't it?
Let me see.
It was a bunch of other games, but now they've just put it as a Capcom sale.
Okay, yeah, I see that now. Yeah, the Capcom Winter Sale.
But originally it was a bunch of other games. Like, it had a Skylanders game for Wii U.
Well, it's possible. Okay, so they just did a sale period during, like, the early part of December and end of November for Nintendo games. So maybe this was supposed to be a third-party game sale.
Maybe. But at the same time, it was a little confusing to not see, for their winter sale, to not see a big Nintendo headliner. Like, even Paper Mario Color Splash. Like, that would have been fine to see as a sale. Like,
I'm looking at it now. I mean, obviously, they relabeled it as they should have at the beginning.
Yeah.
Like, there's a lot of good games on here. They're just no Nintendo games.
Yeah. Well, it had other games on there. Like, I remember they had a list of, like, I guess the most popular. They always do this. Most popular all the way down. And so it had, like, Skylanders Supercharge from $59 to $25. And then it went down Monster Hunter and a bunch of other games. Like, a lot of indies were on
sale. Resident Evil Revelations, $5. Nice.
Yeah. I mean, it's not a bad sale. If you really want some of these Capcom games, but the problem that I was thinking about is that there really wasn't any
Nintendo. Yeah, the initial marketing was not good.
But the most important thing on here is that Solitaire dropped $1 in price.
Christmas. Oh boy.
So, kind of thinking about that, what do you guys think about Nintendo's strategy on sales? Because they don't usually have a lot of good ones.
I think
It can be very hit or miss.
See,
you know, like,
yeah, like, I got in this debate with some people on NeoGAF because someone posted up, why doesn't Nintendo have sales like the PlayStation Network does? And then someone literally gathered up all of Nintendo's sales that they've done for like the past 2 years on Wii U and 3DS, and actually they've outdone the PlayStation Network with sales. In terms of, like, even major games getting discounted. The thing is that their best games don't get discounted. And I don't think they ever are going to get discounted, because that's not what Nintendo does.
Which kind of confuses
me. Color Splash is already discounted at some retailers. It's not discounted. Reasons. Well, yeah, they're too much. Usually, I know you don't like the game, but it's actually
No, I do.
It's reviewed well. But the physical copies aren't selling well, so, you know, they reduce the price. That's just what retailers do.
Well, it's just not a popular game. Yeah. If it doesn't sell well, they're going to reduce the price.
I actually think they've done, having been through that debate and actually looking back at their sales, I don't think it's that bad. I don't like what Steam does with sales, which I know so many people love how Steam does sales. I hate it. I think it's dumb. I think you end up wasting money on games you're never going to play.
Yep, I'm proof of that.
And that's why,
unless you're careful,
I like Nintendo sales because, you know, I see things like, I don't own Resident Evil Revelations, but now for $5, that's worth it to me to go grab that game now that I would have never played otherwise.
You know, here's DuckTales the thing about Nintendo.
Remastered, you know, $6.
They make a premium game and charge a premium price for it, and I appreciate that because when you buy the game, you buy the game, right? You know that you're not going to get DLC that is released a week later or whatever, right?
Yeah.
So I can appreciate them not discounting their titles like that. They never seem to maybe put the games on sale that maybe need a push. I'm a big fan of Xenoblade, and once that came out, it seemed to have been forgotten, right? That's exactly the kind of game that, you know, the average person who doesn't know what that isn't probably going to pay $70 for it, but if it's on sale for 30, $40, they might give it a shot, right? So.
Yeah, and I see, like, I see what Nintendo wants to do in avoiding, like, Steam's mentality, because so many Steam consumers now would be like, why would you ever buy a game at full price? They're going to flash sale next month. And Nintendo not doing those means you can feel confident as a consumer in buying a game day one because, you know, you're not going to feel ripped off that it's going to be $20 cheaper next month.
Well, there is a difference between Steam and Nintendo because I rarely buy the digital copies of Nintendo games because...
Well, that's a whole other...
Well, yeah, but because of the hard drive space and all that. But Nintendo can go, like, the sales, they don't really control the sales in store.
Sure.
That's not really
Or even on Amazon. Amazon always discounts games, but
that's not Nintendo's. They don't have any. They don't really have any say in that. But when it comes to their console, or their, not the virtual console, but their Wii U shop. Like I'm at least surprised that they didn't have like Pokken Tournament discounted for people to go play and
download
and use. I'm not expecting them to just right off the bat discount Pokemon Sun and Moon. Like Nintendo's never been one to just discount a game like that. And you know, typically whenever you see a game that's just come out on Steam that's getting discounted, it's like, okay, Civ 6 is discounted. And it went from $60 to $55. It's not really a discount. You save $5. But looking at games that are still kind of getting... Like, Pokken Tournament's still getting support. It's not as publicized anymore, but it's still getting support. Yep. You'd think that they'd want to discount that and be like, hey, guys, this is a fun...
I think what Nintendo has lost out on with some of those games, like Pokken Tournament... and I'm gonna nail this specifically to games that have online play... is that they are missing out on a secondary market of people who are never going to buy your game, but would jump in for half off. Yeah. And it's a market, I think, that Steam actually does very, very well. Like, you know, you have Civ 6, which it came out recently, but in January there's going to be a flash sale that's half off. It's going to happen, and people who were not going to buy Civ might be tempted to buy it now. And what's important for games like that, like Civ or like Pokken Tournament, is the online functionality. You beef up that online aspect of having more players, which in turn can lead to higher sales day one on Pokken Tournament 2. And I think it's a market Nintendo could hit better, especially on games that just aren't selling that well. Yep. Even if it's a digital-only sale. Now, the only thing I'll say in defense of their digital at this point, outside of the fact that apparently, after doing the research, Nintendo actually has pretty good digital sales compared to their competition in the console market. It's that they don't... Nintendo Digital's in a really bad spot right now. Everything's system-tied. So I almost don't even care about digital sales because I don't want to buy a game I can't guarantee I can take with me on the next system. Rumor has it that the Switch is going to make everything account-based, which is what...
Rumor also had it. That's what the Wii U is going to do, to be fair, as well.
The Wii U rumor was that they were going to get rid of friend codes, and people thought that meant account-based. And it didn't. It still meant system-based, just you don't have to enter a friend code.
Yeah. I don't think Nintendo's ever going to get rid of friend codes.
Friend codes are fine. It's just, this is...
You have... I don't mind if friend codes exist as, like... Like, if you have people with multiple, like, similar usernames, like, a friend code can really help, you know, sort that out. But as long as the big thing with friend codes is you just want to connect with your friends. So, like, now you can look them up by their Wii U username, right, or whatever, the Nintendo Network ID username. Yeah. So, like, you can look them up by username, but if someone has, like, a same username or similar, it is nice having the code because then you can, like, look up them specifically. I don't have a problem with that being a backbone thing, and I think that's going to continue to be like their backbone. Like they're never going to dump it. I just think they need to as soon as they make everything account based, that's when I think we need to start really discussing strong digital sales because I think a lot of people that would be interested in these big digital sales don't care right now because all it means is they do one stupid thing with their credit card, they get their 3DS blocked. They just lost all their games.
I just don't want to buy Super Mario World again. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And there's that too, which... I don't know. It's one of those things where... I think until they solve the issue of console-based versus account-based, I don't care about their digital sales right now.
I think before that, Nintendo just needs to make sure that they have a strong online.
Yes.
Because that's what they were... They were supposed to have that with the Wii U. I think there were rumors about it a while back. They were working with EA or something on their online. It was supposed to be better. It was supposed to be comparable to Xbox.
The only reason I think the Switch might be different is because the entire hardware is being built by NVIDIA.
No. Yeah.
But
I'm just saying, that's one thing that they need to have before they focus on anything else, just to make sure that the online's good, it doesn't run with the really weird gateways, and it's not blocked by a lot of Wi-Fi signals, and it doesn't use specific ones that nothing else uses. It needs to be a console that doesn't strive to be different in the aspect of online. It needs to be a console that strives to be
workable. It could be free still. That'd be nice. Easy to use.
Yeah. I want it to be free. I don't want it. I don't think Nintendo's going to make you pay for online. Like, that's something that I don't think I can see them doing. But I don't think they need to strive to be different, being like, oh, well, you know, we need to have, like, friend codes for every game again, because that obviously worked.
People love that.
Just, yeah. Even with Super Mario Run, I can't believe they brought back friend codes for Super Mario Run.
I can't believe they took away online functionality. In Mario Maker for 3DS?
That
like,
was rough. You just killed for Christmas,
like,
for sure.
Like you just destroyed like 80% of this game. Like, oh.
Yep.
For some people, maybe it's still worth it. It is cool to have the addition of exchanging like stages in person, but that should be in addition to online functionality. It's just Nintendo does some weird things.
I don't think they know what to do with online yet. Well, I still don't think that they're 100%
sure. A lot of their franchises are single-player experiences. So, like, they personally, outside of a couple games, don't have to worry about online. So I think that's why you see them so far behind. Like, what's Microsoft's flagship franchise? An online multiplayer shooter.
I mean, if you guys have ever played Smash Online, you'll know that it's awkward. There's one match, it takes forever to load. They definitely don't have the practice with it. And I mean, the other thing too, this is probably gonna be like a duh thing to say, but like, to make online work, like they gotta put more emphasis into making games where online is a pillar of the game, right? Like Splatoon, perfect example.
Yeah.
And they, you know, you can't talk to your friends, you can't set up a chat room for your friends. It was a disaster in terms of, I mean, the game is awesome, but that, like, coordinating with your buddies to play, it was just a nightmare.
Yeah.
Well, when it launched too, there was no, you couldn't have matches with your friends at all. That was something they added later.
Yeah.
But I will say that the Wii U's online functionality is miles better than the Wii's.
Yeah.
Oh, if you ever tried back in the day to play Brawl online, I don't know. I tried.
I thought I had like two frames a second.
What was
that WeakNet 24 thing that they had?
So miles better. Like, I think they're stepping in the right direction.
I think they need to fully hand over online functionality to a company who knows what they're doing.
Yeah.
And I think maybe this is why I'm cautiously optimistic about online with the Switch next year, because no one in the world thought they were going to ever hand over hardware to a Western company. And they did. They gave NVIDIA the reins and said, look, you've made something similar to our idea. Make this thing for us. And not only are they making it, they're handling all the dev tools for it, which means things are going to be easy to port from, like, PC to this thing. And that's great. So I'm hoping that that NVIDIA also said, well, hey, look, we have online functionality, you know, with our old Tegra tech and all this stuff. Like, do you want us to do something with that? And I hope Nintendo's like, yeah, you just do it because we suck.
And you know what? Don't stop there. Hand over your IPs to developers that are experienced in online play, right? Like...
They're never going to do that.
It's worked well for them in the past. Capcom made the Minish games, the Oracle games. Those were awesome. Sega made F-Zero.
Yeah, but none of those were... Yeah, but those weren't
online.
I'm living
in a pipe dream here, but...
Games.
Well, also,
if we could have
those weren't mainline...
That Retro brought, only with an online IP, then...
I'd like to see them... Because a lot of the companies, like Capcom back then, like, that was Capcom in their heyday. They were almost as good as Nintendo in terms of producing quality games back then. Nowadays, they make. They still make good Monster Hunter games.
I mean, nowadays, and Resident Evil and Mega Man are shells of what they used to be.
Yeah, I mean, Ace Attorney's still good, but for the most part, they don't really make a lot of high-quality games anymore that are really good. So, like, you start thinking, what companies would you even trust to touch Nintendo's IP?
Yacht Club.
Konami.
Yeah. I mean, Konami's now, you know, got down the crapper.
Give them a team,
you know,
Metroid.
Yacht Club. Sure, Yacht Club. But again, you know, if Nintendo's going to make a partnership, it's going to be with a high AAA publisher company they think they can trust.
Platinum Games is probably the closest
we might see. they might trust them.
Well,
with
like, remember, I kind of view it as the same thing, like when we talk about fan games. is that Nintendo is so protective of their IP and their property that they'd want to either have the most hands-on approach or they'd be like a helicopter parent watching every single move that those developers made.
And that's tough, and that's why we only get a Nintendo game once every 3 months, too.
It's crazy. We only get a Nintendo game once every 3 months. That's more often than every other company out there, but...
Well, that's why, like, I can't see them... Unless they, like, let off the reins a little on those other developers that they gave properties to. And I think you can kind of look at it, too. Metroid Other M didn't sell as well, or didn't do as well. I think Nintendo
needs to do something they've already kind of sort of done. They bought out Retro Studios. So now that's a Western developer company that they own that makes games. You know, it's like one every 4 years or whatever. Whatever, they make games. You know, Next Level Games, they don't own them, but they've made them so happy, all they want to do is make Nintendo games. So they're like in Canada, and they just make 3DS games all the time. Or now they're probably working on a Switch game. But, you know, I think Nintendo needs to do more stuff like that, where in the past they've only been willing to work with Western studios, or I'm sorry, Eastern. So, like, Japan and stuff. And a lot of those studios, besides Square Enix, have basically gone to crap. You know, Platinum Games has kind of risen up. But, you know, Platinum, it seems to be unwilling to want to be, like, an exclusive Nintendo partner. They want to still make games for everything. Which is fine. That's what they want to do. That's what they've survived on. But I think Nintendo needs to do more with what they've done with, like, Retro Studios or with Next Level Games. Like, find these kind of smaller Western studios that have the ability to make like B-tier games and just heavily invest in them to the point that they become basically exclusive makers, and then you kind of start mixing things up. You still have your Nintendo EAD. You can still, you know, team up with Platinum now and then, or was it Grezzo? But then you'd also still have more games coming out more often because you'd have more Western studios making games for you. Like right now, I think they only have two Western studios that make games.
Quick trivia question. Do you guys remember, who was the developer that made Eternal Darkness? Silicon Knights, is that right?
Silicon Knights, yeah. They're out of business.
Yeah. Well, they renewed the trademark.
Oh, for the franchise, didn't they? Which to me, I know a lot of people try to look into that stuff. I think I've realized now that these renewed trademarks on these names, it just means they're bringing it to Virtual Console someday. So they can resell it. Because...
Yeah.
Or like, I would have liked to see them... Like, there's a perfect game out there. The Dennis Dyack guy, who was part of that team that made that game, that some people hate because of some shady stuff he did way back when. We were just talking about Eternal Darkness. Yeah, Dennis Dyack was one of the main guys on that team, but he did some really crappy stuff back then. Anyways, he was one of the main guys heading up a new project that was just like Eternal Darkness. I forget what it was called, Shadow of the Eternals or something.
I don't know what you're talking about.
And that Kickstarter failed, but I view that as kind of like, look at what Nintendo's been doing lately with funding games. And now they might have picked up that one game that's Switch exclusive. They just unveiled it.
Heaven...
Seasons of Heaven. The developer said that Nintendo picked it up. So like, you're sitting there and you're like, okay, Nintendo picked up Seasons of Heaven. They did Devil's Third in the past. They picked up Bayonetta 2. Like maybe Nintendo's strategy to get these games now or get more games is to find projects like this that aren't being picked up by anybody and saying, hey, why don't you bring that to our platform?
Well, that's the hope for like Darksiders 3 too, and companies like that that like they have all these games and these companies that want to make them, but aren't getting a lot of funding.
Like that's what I'm with Seasons of Heaven. They pitched to EA and a couple other people, and they're like, "Eh, it's not good enough."
Yeah,
and Nintendo's like, "This thing is freaking gorgeous. We'll give you some money, make it happen. Yeah. Switch exclusive."
And it's the same thing. Bayonetta 2 was a game that a lot of people wanted that nobody would pick up, and Nintendo, surprisingly,
an M-rated game.
Nintendo funded Nintendo that game.
And I think maybe that's how Nintendo's going to be going forward. Like, I want another Eternal Darkness. Nintendo might never make one in-house, but Shadow of the Eternals is sitting out there, and they could easily be like, hey, we'll throw money behind it, bring it, make it Switch exclusive, and we're good to go. And Nintendo seems... Yeah. It's actually kind of refreshing that Nintendo seems to be so willing to do that. And I think maybe that's a way they can develop relationship with these companies and get them to make, you know, Switch exclusive games. Because they did that with Image and Form. They helped them release one of their early games on the 3DS. And ever since then, Image and Form is perfectly happy making like tons of 3DS games. And now, you know, now they're making like a Nintendo Switch game or something. But it's it's interesting. I think the Switch is going to end up having more support than we've seen any other Nintendo console have in a long time.
That was kind of my positive for Nintendo this year. Admittedly, not the most positive year for Nintendo, but the one thing that I took away that I liked the most about them was that they were a little bit more willing to hand the reins over a little bit in terms of hardware, software, just all that stuff. So, I hope that continues. Like, they'll be in a good spot.
Yeah, 2016 to me felt like the year Nintendo realized... they had to make these decisions before 2016, but it was kind of the year that they realized that they really screwed up this generation. So, like, we're done making games for Wii U. It's just not going to happen. The thing doesn't sell. It's a waste of money. We don't have anything to show you at E3 because we haven't unveiled the system yet, and we're not ready to unveil it. So we're going to show you Breath of the Wild because everybody wants to see that thing, and we almost have this game done, and we think it's good enough. It's going to drive hype. And, you know, when we did the Switch, we're going to allow NVIDIA to release a press release that basically says, yeah, we made the Switch. That's just the way it is. And had that be a recognition of Nintendo being like, yeah, we realize that our business is more Western-based than Eastern, and we need to cater to that. And we're not doing it.
Well, at the same time, they're acting in this sense, the stuff that we've talked about, more like producers instead of directors. Aside from Breath of the Wild,
and that is a great IPs, analogy.
That they're producing, they're producing the hardware as opposed to like having a. I mean, I don't doubt that.
Oh, sure, they totally
how it's being built and how it's being put together. Yeah, but like to give the reins to someone else and be like, okay, well, we'll watch you, we'll monitor you, but you pretty much have free reign over the like to create this idea that we have.
Here's our idea. Make it
like a Marvel movie. Each one is unique, but in the same.
Yeah, and.
Same universe.
Mm-hmm. And so they gave them the money to do that, and they did it with all these other games, and they're kind of like, okay, well, there's, you know, we don't have to do everything. I think that that's what Nintendo's really learned so far, or the past 2 years, is, you know, we don't have to do this all of this on
our
own.
And that's what I like about the Switch, and it's actually what I like about Nintendo releasing games on smart devices now, is... I think Nintendo is starting to realize that their strength is in making content rather than necessarily making hardware. And this doesn't mean I want Nintendo going third party. I think if they had gone third party, things like the Switch would just never exist or never get popular. And that would suck. Like the idea of a one system that plays everything and you can hook up your TV and take it with you, like that's not new. Some tablets have been able to do that, but none of them got popular. I don't want Nintendo getting out of the hardware business because without them, things like this wouldn't be possible. But it's one of those things where Nintendo's like, look, our strength isn't hardware, but we still have ideas. So if we team with people whose strength is hardware, like NVIDIA, they could create something together that they both want to really succeed, get marketing from Nintendo and marketing from them, and be able to draw upon their connections, because NVIDIA has lots of connections to different people and different companies, and work together on that so Nintendo can focus more on making games, whether it's for the Switch, whether it's for the 3DS, whether it's for phones, and just focus on that. Like, even Miyamoto said, like, I'm not really making any Switch stuff right now. My focus is on these games for phones. That's a good market for Miyamoto. That's a good use of... Mm-hmm. He likes making games for broader audiences. That's a perfect thing for him to make those games on. And I think this is a good strategy for Nintendo to broaden themselves and focus on games. Like, I know a lot of people are like, oh, well, they're making games on phones now, so they're going to make less games for console. I think they're going to make more games for consoles. I don't think the teams are even closely related, like the teams they have working on phones and the teams they have working on the Switch.
I think if the 3DS is done within, let's see, a year from the Switch launch, there's no question probably. They're going to be making more games.
The only reason that they're not killing off the 3DS like the Wii is because, one, the 3DS is more popular. And as Pokemon just showed, games can still sell on the system. And they basically want a fallback. Like, they released the Switch, and it tanks like the Wii U did. they still could be like, well, we never replaced the 3DS, so we can release the 4DS now. You know, they want that fallback plan. And in many ways, that's what the DS was with the 3DS. I mean, the 3DS released, and then like 2 weeks later, wasn't it Black and White 2 came out exclusively to the DS? So it was they kind of plan, if the 3DS thing doesn't take off, well, we're still keeping the DS going.
To any artists that are listening, can you give us some concept art of a 4DS?
Nintendo always likes playing it safe. Like when the DS came out, it wasn't a Game Boy Advance replacement. It ended up replacing it, but it was like, if this idea fails, we still have the Game Boy Advance. Mm-hmm. So I think that's what they're doing. The Wii U already failed. There's no point in trying to sugarcoat it. So just call this thing a home console. Say it's replacing the Wii U. Keep the 3DS going for at least 1 year. And if the Switch takes off, then the 3DS is done. Kind of thing.
Yep, I think so.
Which I think all of us want the Switch to succeed. Because if it succeeds, it means it's doing something right.
I think if the Switch doesn't succeed, like this is it for them making hardware, I'm going to be playing Mario on my Xbox.
I don't know. I think you'll be playing Mario PlayStation.
Mobile.
They'll team with Sony before
I think
team
one of the benefits about...
Sony and Nintendo still owe me a Mario movie.
One of the benefits about mobile, too, is... I'm not touching that one again. You want a Mario movie February 13th when that...
Oh, baby. I'm excited for that.
That's why this whole touch of the IP thing started. Bob Hoskins.
No, they're not doing that now. Now they're just building worlds of Mario in the real world for us to go visit at theme parks.
Which is better.
And mobile, too.
And on mobile.
Yeah.
Which is a good thing. Like, that's a good platform for them to work with because those games don't
is anyone
take too
playing
long
Super
to
Mario
develop.
No,
stuff?
I have an Android.
No, I don't have an iPhone.
I am,
too.
I'm an Android guy, and so I don't...
you play it next year.
Yeah, when nobody's playing anymore.
In 2 years.
Well, you'll have the whole Android user base playing.
I did catch a Ditto, though, that was cool.
Yeah.
I bought Super Mario Run. It's good.
Thanks.
Nintendo did it right. The marketing for it's if I wasn't a Nintendo fan, it's really weird. Because, you play it for, 3 minutes, and it's like, spend $10 to play the rest of the game. If I wasn't already a fan of Nintendo, that would have been really off-putting. They didn't ease you into that very well. But once you spend the money, the game is definitely worth it. It's really addicting.
Yeah.
Yes.
Good replay value. We talked about this last week. It's a good $10.
I applaud them.
I wish they would have a
premium price for a premium game too, right?
Yeah, well, and that's the thing. That's why the investors think it's such a bad thing to do because you don't do this on mobile devices. All right, so we finally release games on mobile devices, but you're pissed off how we charge money for it. You can't win. Everything has to be Pokemon Go. Everything.
Well, I think the benefit to that is for mobile is that they have all these other games, like these other IPs that they could take to mobile.
They have other IPs that are better suited for what those people want this game to be.
WarioWare.
Or WarioWare. Animal Crossing is a game I can see them microtransactioning the hell out of.
Oh, please no.
Oh, yeah.
And if they don't... They might not do it with your phone. Buy DLC on your phone. They'll just sell you more of those Amiibo cards. And then you have to scan in the QR code to get your stuff. They already do that with... They already do that with Animal Crossing. It's a thing that exists already. They're going to bring that to phone.
I'm aware.
They're going to do that on your phone. I don't know why they wouldn't. It's a moneymaker.
Yeah.
And it's a way for them to tie physical media to your phone. Oh, and now when you buy the new Animal Crossing Amiibo, they have QR codes on the bottom.
Oh, God, I don't think they're ever going to make Animal Crossing
Amiibo. So now Amiibo works with your phone.
No, I feel like it'd be tied in.
A lot of phones already have NFC readers anyways, so...
Yeah, some...
Why wouldn't they make it compatible anyways?
Because iPhones don't.
Well,
our Android's got to count for something, right?
No, they do have NFC.
Like I said, I'm an Android.
That's why why you can use Apple Pay is because it's NFC.
Yeah, Apple Pay is because it's got the NFC chip in it. And I was like,
wait a second. Whether or not they've unlocked that chip for other people to use, I have no idea. But
so, kind of moving to a more positive note in general. So this year, there's been a lot of negativity, especially around things like the election, and that's probably the most negative event that's happened this year. And a lot of people, there's been a lot of hate, there's been a lot of bad things that happened, but I want to focus on the good. So I kind of want to go around and talk about things that happened to us, or things that happened this year that made 2016 great for us. Like, it's nothing bad, just like the good, the bad, and the best. Or the good, the better, the best about 2016. Like, what did you like?
You go first, Alfred.
What? Why don't I go first?
You go first. Let's hear it.
Okay. Yeah, right? I'm just like, how can I think of positive things? Like, Carrie Fisher just died.
That was tough.
I know. That's why you gotta be positive. Like, be positive.
That one singer just died.
It was tough. I had literally just seen Rogue One and came out of the theater and read that what had happened to Carrie Fisher, and it was just really jarring to... spoiler alert to anyone that had just seen her face to see that. So that was really tough.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So that's what I want to focus
on. All right, Alfred, you start, because all I can think is negative right now.
So I've got a few positives. I got engaged this year.
Hey, woo! Congratulations!
That's a good thing. Back in June. I got relatively good grades in my grad courses this year. Woo! I got all A's in my grad courses this year. So, like, just small stuff like that in terms of school. It's just been a good year. I've been actually a lot healthier than I've been in past years.
We started the Zelda Former podcast.
Oh, yeah, hey. That's right. Started the Zelda Former podcast. Has it
been a full year?
In this next month, in January, it'll be a full year at Zelda Former for me.
Oh, yep.
Yeah. And then, We got Breath of the Wild info, which was really good. Switch was announced. I don't know if this is going to apply to any of you guys, but one of my favorite bands of all time, the Proto Man, finally released their short film for Light Up the Night, which we've been waiting on for like 4 years now.
Nice.
And so that was really good. I was really glad about that. In terms of, I don't know, other things that were really good, two animes came out that I really enjoyed this year. Probably my top two of all time now. So that was nice. I'm hoping for some second seasons to those. Erase isn't going to get a second season of this. Probably my favorite anime that's come out this year. Then ReZero. Other than that, it's just like, you know, there's ups and downs every year for me, but it's been a pretty good year in terms of how things are going in my sphere. I'm currently unemployed. That's kind of a negative, but I'm still looking for a job. So that's a positive, I guess. I don't know. Hire me, someone. All right, who's next?
All right, well, I'll go, I guess, since I'm alphabetically next on our voice chat. this year, I started a Zelda Informer as well. So that was a big deal for me, because I've been doing things online like YouTube since like 2007. Nothing has ever taken off, and working with Zelda Informer doing YouTube videos has been like the most positive reception, the most like amazing thing for me to do. Especially because it's talking about my favorite games. so that's great. And then also Nathan asked me to help with Nintendo Prime as well, so we just released our first video there. Awesome. I changed work at my day job. I work way better, more hours, and better hours, and you know, got some raises and stuff, so that's... raises are good. I got my first 3DS ever, because I'm really? Like 5 years behind. Yeah, actually what I got was the... you'll see it on the video. It's the Black Friday one.
The Galaxy one or whatever?
Not the Galaxy one. The Mario... I got the Mario Black one. There was a black and a white one. So I'm really happy with that. And I got my NES Classic at launch because my wife decided that she was going to get up at 6 in the morning and go get it for me.
You're lucky, man.
Yeah, she's a keeper. So
I hope so at this point.
Yeah. Family stuff has been good. my son's going to school or preschool, and so there's a lot of time for me to go to work and then like come home and edit and work on videos and then have family time as well. So it's like, in general, I'd say my entire quality of life has improved this year. Mm-hmm. So it's been a good experience overall for me.
Awesome.
So who's next
on line then? Okay, I'll go next.
Okay.
So yeah, one of the coolest things I did this year was take a trip to Costa Rica with my girlfriend for a couple weeks. So that was cool. I've never really been anywhere before, anywhere exotic before. So we traveled around the country, stayed in a few different hostels, met a bunch of different people, saw a bunch of different animals. That was really cool. So that was a game changer for me. So now I've kind of got the travel bug. So that was just a really awesome experience. What else? We got Stranger Things. Ooh. Love that. Most of my other movies I was looking forward to this year disappointed me, but Stranger Things blew me away.
Still have to watch that show.
Oh, it's so good. Yeah, I changed jobs, so that was cool. Everyone in my family is healthy. So I moved into a new apartment, got a pretty killer view of the city, so that was nice. Got a bunch of new stuff. Finally adulted my apartment a little bit and threw out some of my old posters. So that was cool. And sounds probably kind of cheesy, but like Zelda Inform has been really cool. I started like less than a month ago, so it was something that I always thought about doing. Now I just have a little bit more time to do it. So I was into podcasting. I had a show a couple years ago, and we stopped that. So just getting back into it, into writing blogs and coming on shows has been really really cool. All
right, Nate, you're up.
Still on the negatives over here. So let me see. I went to E3 this year.
Oh yeah, that's right. I'm still jealous about that.
Hey, yeah, you got to play Breath of the Wild 6 times. You don't awesome. Get to talk about being negative.
Yeah. It feels like so long ago now. Yes, I probably get to play Breath of the Wild more than anyone but Nintendo Treehouse employees there. because that's the only reason I was there. Nintendo Prime didn't exist. I had literally no other reason to drop $3,000 and go to LA besides Zelda, so... you're darn right. I was going to try to make that $3,000 worth it. Whether 6 playthroughs of a demo makes it worth it, I have no idea.
Well, that was worth
but,
it.
So, like, there's a positive, but there was a huge negative to it. So, especially when I have 3 children. But it is what it is. I don't know if I'm going to be going to E3 anytime soon again. it's really hard to justify that kind of budget. But it was fun. It was awesome. I guess I don't regret it. How could you regret playing Breath of the Wild, right? but yeah, so that was really cool. And it's really cool that the 1E3 I go to is the one that's dedicated to Zelda, which has been like my life for 18 years covering it online. So it was really cool that that's the 1E3 that I did go to. Beyond that... Well, I launched Nintendo Prime, which it's had a lot of ups and downs. It's kind of in a down period right now because of the holidays. We were doing really, really well up until like a week before Christmas. And then I just kind of said, you know what? I'm not even going to try to struggle to get content out. I'm just going to stop. And unfortunately, that stop also meant Zelda Informer stopped. Which is really, really weird since I had already had like a month off from Zelda Informer, but I think it's not just that I stopped. Darren also stopped for the holidays. So, yeah, when the top 2 guys at Zelda Informer both stopped doing work for a couple of weeks, things tend not to get done. but that's okay. I'm back now. Obviously, I'm here doing the podcast. I got an editorial and another post out earlier today, and I've actually been updating the news queue the entire time we've been recording. so, like, I'm trying to get caught up, and I'm like, well, no wonder there hasn't been anything written. The queue's been empty for, like, a week. But, no, so, yeah, launch Nintendo Prime, that's been really, really exciting, really stressful. It's a lot more work than I thought it was going to be, but it's also not as hard. I don't know. It's weird. More work than I thought it was going to be, but the work's not as hard as I thought it was going to be.
You have practice.
You know, and I think one of the most exciting things I launched out of that is the Nintendo Prime podcast, which is finally the kind of podcast I've always wanted to be part of, but didn't know how because I don't know a lot of people in my area that like the same games I do. But because that's like an in-person podcast, like I have a whole studio set up like over in another room in my house for it. So it's really cool. That's been fun. Beyond that, obviously, still with my girlfriend. That's exciting. There's moments this year I didn't think we'd still be together right now, but we are. So that's always good. Let me see there. My children are another year older. Which means my daughter just started her first day of school, or her first year of school this year. Always stressful as for any parent. Like at first you're like, oh, I'm relieved. They're gone all day. But you don't realize how much you miss them until they're not here.
That's true.
I miss my cat when I go to work. Like
your cat is not the same, dude.
Yeah, I can only imagine.
Well, in the day of this recording, my oldest son started his first day of daycare, which has given me a lot of free time, which is actually why I chose this day to come back work at the site, because I knew I was going to have more time. But it also was really, really hard because I've every day of that kid's life, I have had him here like all day with me. Whereas with my daughter, I'm like a stepdad. So the first 9 months of her life, I didn't even know who she was. Whereas with this kid, I wasn't working the first 9 months of his life. So I was the full-time parent. So like I have, you know, I kind of have that connection with this kid that I might not ever get with my daughter, of where he has basically been my life for 3 years. So having him not be here for a whole day was very difficult for me today. But he had a really, really good day at daycare. So like, that's awesome. So I guess I'm that's sad but happy. Again, all my moments are sad but happy, I think. I'll get used to it eventually. Like, I'm going to really appreciate not having him here when I'm working. It's open former, let me tell you. How little work I get done when he is here is baffling. Like, how can you get so little done? I'm like, yeah, you have a three-year-old. Tell me. Tell me how short you get done. I know exactly the feeling. I have a one-year-old on top of that, plus the six-year-old daughter. So, anyways.
Oh, man.
It's a lot in this house. But yeah, no, it's been a very interesting year. Lots of ups, lots of downs. I don't want to say 2016 is a year I want to forget, but it's definitely going to be a year that I hope I have enough adult fun on the 31st to not remember much of. Cause we are like, I have, my sister is going to be watching the kids all day Saturday and most of Sunday. So, I might not be conscious, but that's okay. It's going to be fun.
If the site crashes, we'll know why.
Yeah. the site.
Nate tried to publish another gender.
Thing is, I don't publish those things.
That was me. I'm sorry.
I've like never written on that topic my entire time at Zelda.
No, Moon. I know. But just imagine like a drunken Nate typing.
You know how many fans?
Like, you know what? Zelda should be a girl.
You know what's going to suck about that night? I'm going out to drink, and at midnight, supposedly right now, this is the plan. At midnight, Massey's is flipping a switch to turn our site over from Expression Engine to WordPress. And I'm not going to be here if shit hits the fan, so this is going to be awesome. I'm trying to tell him, like, wait till later in the day when I'm around. But we'll see. He's really adamant on like hitting it at midnight. I'm like, I'd be more adamant that everything works.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
that's not what I'm going to be doing.
The thing is, like if fans aren't going to notice it on the front end, then there's no need to rush it. Like, you know, let's do it right. But he has a bit of my attitude at times where I'm like, I got this good idea, so I just want to do it, regardless of what the consequences are. Like, that's what I think. I don't know. That's why I don't think I'm going to be conscious on Sunday, because I'm going to make some bad decisions, and I'm going to be okay with that.
Like I said, I'm just expecting a Link should be a female.
No, see, the thing is, if this was like 7 years ago when I didn't have kids or a girlfriend, that's what happened. I would go out and get drunk, come home at 3 a.m., and I would write like 3 editorials and just post them. No proofreading, no idea what I'm writing about. Wake up the next day and be like, what the hell did I just put on Zelda Informer? Well, can't...
I wonder if that's
can't what, delete it now.
I wonder if that's what Darren was like when he wrote his article.
Oh my gosh. Yeah, it's... You know, for all the bad that's happened in 2016, you know, there's just a lot of... I guess a lot of clarifications I want to say in my life. Clarifying, like, even my position at Zelda Informer. You know, a lot of our fans might not know, but Zelda Informer was sold at the very beginning of 2016. To a new owner, which put my future in uncertain territory. And thankfully, I've been fortunate enough to be editor-in-chief all throughout 2016, and I'm going to be editor-in-chief for at least 4 more months. That's how long my contract goes for. And it's a really stressful time right here at the end of 2016 that I'm not going to get into why it's stressful, because it's behind-the-scenes stuff. But... let's just say there might be a lot changing at Zelda Informer 2017. And I don't just mean, like, with me and what I do. But 2016 really clarified just a lot of, like, what that relationship with the new owner is going to be like for Zelda Informer in the future. You know, a lot of clarifications in my personal life, like what my relationship really is with my girlfriend versus what maybe I thought it was. A lot of clarifications with my children on... what terrible threes are like. What E3 is actually like. You know, what Breath of the Wild's going to be. What the Switch is going to be. It's been like the year of clarifications, filled with the year of a lot of people I really, really liked in the entertainment industry dying.
And yet somehow Stan Lee is
still alive. 94.
There you go.
Dude, that guy's gonna live. Yeah, he's gonna live until we figure out how to cryogenically freeze him.
Mm-hmm. He's gonna be in the Avengers 7 for sure, making a cameo somewhere.
Oh, he's in like everything. Like it. I'm living to see the day. That Spider-Man's gonna be in a video with Iron Man, like an actual Spider-Man movie, but it has Iron Man in it.
Did you see the awesome trailer for the new Spider-Man?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah,
that's why I said, like, I never thought I'd see the day that a Spider-Man movie would actually have Iron Man in it. And now it's happening, and I'm excited.
It's just not Tobey Maguire. I know you're a little disappointed.
You know what? Tobey was fine in Spider-Man 1 and 2.
The Spider-Man 3 was just, it wasn't his fault. It was just a bad movie.
That wasn't just a bad movie. That was the worst movie I've ever seen. I get like, so angry about that
time I talk about it. I was so excited for that movie because it had, like, one of my favorite plot lines.
Yeah, I know.
And they just screwed it up. I'm like, how do you screw this up?
I'll never forget him doing his emo dance.
Oh my god.
The studio was really pressuring the director, what's his name? Sam Raimi.
Yeah,
Sam Raimi. They were like really pressuring him to just put more and more and more into the movie until it became this big inflated mess.
Let's put a goblin
on it. More villains. It needs more villains.
Well, and what upset me is, right, like, so they reboot Spider-Man with the Amazing Spider-Man, and I end up really liking that, and then they just get rid of it.
Well, they did the same exact thing that they did with Spider-Man 3. They were like, you know what? Amazing Spider-Man 2 needs 3 villains.
I thought Amazing Spider-Man 1 was okay, but 2 is just so
bad. Yeah, no, 2... Like, two like an electric Smurf. Yeah, like, I'm not saying 2 was bad, but I thought they had the right Spider-Man person. And to like, because it was different enough from what Tobey did, where they could have redeemed themselves with a third movie. And
I thought it was interesting, the whole like kind of murder mystery, I guess, about his parents. I thought that was kind of cool. It was a fresh take rather than seeing Uncle Ben get shot again.
It was literally taking the... You guys ever watched the 90s? Oh,
yeah.
Yes.
That's what that plotline was. That his parents
that's why I liked it.
Spies or something like that. Yeah, I love that take, but I was like, and we're never going to get to see that.
And now I like the take they're doing now where it's like a high school kid or whatever. Like,
yeah, now it's more like
spectacular. Yeah, like I'm okay with it, and it's hard not to be because I love what they've been doing with that whole universe in the movies. So it's hard for me not to like. It's almost like, oh, Tony Stark is in it, so I'm going to like it. It's just the way it is.
I don't know if I'm still sold on the Vulture as a villain, though. Like, he looks good enough in the movie, but he was always so lame in the cartoon to me. He's got that stigma to me of just being like that lame old man.
Yeah,
it's kind of like, but it is Michael Keaton.
I mean, yeah, that's true. He's Batman.
Yeah, and I just look at it as I trust. Like, I have not yet watched like a movie in that universe that has been terrible. Like, Iron Man 3 isn't terrible. It's just not even close to as good as what the previous movies were. But but on its own, it's still an okay movie.
I'm going to go ahead and say Civil War was actually one of my biggest disappointments of this year. I was expecting, I don't know. I was expecting greatness because the trailer was so good, and it just fell apart after the airport scene.
To be honest, I just saw Rogue One last night. I'm not disappointed. I just, it almost seems like
you didn't like it as much as you thought it would.
I didn't know what to think about it, right? Because it's a tweener movie, right? Mm-hmm. It's supposed to explain how they got the Death Star plans. Like that's great. Like, because that was never explained in A New Hope, and it's good to finally have clarification on how that happened. But it almost felt like a forgettable movie.
I think
it's not a bad movie. It's not bad. Yeah, it's just it didn't need to exist per se. Like, if the movie never happened, it wouldn't have really mattered.
What was her name? Yeah. The main girl's name?
Jin.
See, the problem for me is I didn't like Jin. Like,
and the thing you know about this movie is that any new major characters they introduce have to die because they're not there.
Well, they have to have
a way to explain them out of the future story. And
I was fine with that. And it's just she's very unlikable. Like, she was kind of in it for herself until all of a sudden she wasn't. Like, you know.
Well, the problem is the character motivations for that flipped so quickly that you didn't see the character evolution.
Well, and I think that's because I knew the characters were all going to die.
Yeah, it was going from the third act on. It just like hit a roadblock and then sped right past.
I never believed
it.
That she would just and all of so a sudden then, like. Take charge of that meeting and everyone was rallying around her. That just seemed kind of weird to me. Like, I mean, I'm not like the hugest Star Wars fan. I like them all, but I didn't really like her and I didn't really like
this
guy with the mask.
And I think, like, of all the movies, that was the most disappointing because I don't want to say I went in with high expectations because I really didn't. I was just kind of wondering what kind of movie is this going to be because it's a tweener movie where we already knows what happens in the future. So, they're trying to explain something we don't know about with characters that aren't going to be around. You know, and they can't really do things like have Princess Leia heavily involved because the actress is too old and any appearance by her is going to be brief, just like it was going to be brief with Vader. And Vader is a character they could have had around more because it's a guy in a costume.
Vader's first appearance was lame when he was talking to what's-his-face, but the second one where he was kicking ass was awesome.
Oh, yeah.
Can we just be honest? Wasn't it weird that Vader's hips swayed
when he
walked? I was
Vader's milkshake. But it's one of those things that maybe my disappointment is because I liked Episode 7 a lot. Yeah. Like, I thought it was probably the best they possibly could do with how far after episode 6 that they had to make this video. They used a lot of old tropes in the series, but that's fine. You can use tropes of the own series you're part of. How many video games do that? Like, you can do that. You know, having Han Solo die, like, you can do that. That's okay. Whatever. It's over a year after.
Say, like, I'm not a super Star Wars fan, but Episode 7 was my favorite of all the Star Wars.
Like it's really good. So I think it's just because I came off that high of this is really good, and now we have Rogue One, which is reviewing okay. I go watch it, and I'm like, oh, you know, this is 7 just set the bar, and this movie's not even close. Mm-hmm. There's moments in it I like. You know, I loved a lot of the battle scenes. Mm-hmm. Like, it reminded me of old school Empire Strike Back kind of thing. Like, it was really sweet, but it's like, okay, but that's it. Just a lot of confusion for me. I don't know. I mean, the overall plot line for the Death Star and the plans, like, I liked it. I just, I don't know. It's just
something
that
it was good. It could have been great. is my
yeah opinion, it felt right? Like it could have been better, but I keep thinking I don't know how they could have done it better.
That I can't come up with an Civil idea War. Like it was good, it was even quite good. It was just, it could have been great and it wasn't, and it really fell apart at the end when they stopped fighting, but then they made up, and then they started fighting again, and like Iron Man was mad at him because Winter Soldier killed his parents, even though everybody knows he was brainwashed. And I was like, what? Yeah. What's going on
like
here?
Like one...
Oh, thank you for reminding me that I still have Civil War II.
I thought you were going to say thanks finale. For reminding me. I haven't seen it yet.
No. No, I got the very last issue of Civil War II today, and I still haven't read it, so I'll probably...
Well, yeah. This. What's up?
What did you guys... Did you guys see
Assassin's Creed? No, not yet. I was cautiously optimistic about that, and I saw that IGN was kind of dumping all over it, which kind of sucks.
Well, that's no surprise.
I feel like it's another case of like the Batman v Superman and Suicide Squad, because a lot of people I've talked to love it, but a lot of critics don't. I loved the movie. I've never played an Assassin's Creed game. I've played like the first 5 minutes of 3, because I got it for free with the Ubisoft 30 thing. But I have no idea, other than what I've watched friends play for Assassin's Creed.
Well, the movie
Creed
is its own thing. So, I played Assassin's Creed up till 3.
Yeah,
so yeah,
it is.
It was his own beast.
And I thought it was really good. I thought it was a really good movie. There were like one or two choices I didn't understand with editing. But other than that, I thought it was really good. I don't understand some of the hate behind it.
I'm going to go see it, I think.
But like, I was just wondering really if you guys... Cool.
I think, to me, it's... See, I'm a big Assassin's Creed fan. I've played all of the games except the most recent one.
Syndicate or whatever.
Syndicate. And I heard that Syndicate's actually, once they patched everything, it's not that bad. But I kind of sort of lose an interest because I'm one of the few people that really liked the outside story that connected the whole universe together.
The Desmond Mild one?
The Desmond Mild, the Animus.
I thought that was pretty cool. I remember like walking above the UFC fight or whatever it was in Brazil in Assassin's Creed 3 or something like that. I thought that was wicked.
Yeah, like they did I really liked what they did all the way through 3, and then they kind of ended that story arc in a way that I think was really poor, and then they try to introduce, you know, a new story arc into why all this stuff is happening, and I just haven't connected with it. And, you know, I'm hoping that this break they're taking with the series, and whenever they bring it back, that they recognize the importance of having a better interconnected world like that.
I just think that's what happens when you have annualized sequels, right? Like, there's your best ideas, boom, and boom, and boom, and right again until you have nothing left except for...
It's hard to keep it interwoven when you have so many different studios working on an interconnected story. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what ended up killing the story for me.
I Black Flag, and that was too jarring for me.
Yeah, I liked Black Flag, the actual parts when you're being a pirate. Like, I'm like, this is really cool. Like, I like it. It's good. But everything else feels so disconnected. I'd
recommend seeing this because it deals heavily with outside of the past. Like, a lot of it focuses on the Animus.
Movie, to me, I think it's going to be like the Tomb Raider movies, where... They're not really reviewed that well, but people that watch it like it, and that's why there was like three
of the best video game movies, and Tomb Raider is what immediately popped in my
mind. Well, basically Tomb Raider and I love Super Mario Bros. Movie, man. I wish there was a second one, but no, when I think of the best, like the most successful ones outside of animated series, which I'm gonna throw those as a side thing, is they got... Tomb Raider had, like, a 3 or 4 movie run. Resident Evil had a good run.
Trailer for the last one today.
Yeah, but isn't, like, the next final one, like, that's chapter. It? Yeah. I thought the next one's, like, the last one they're doing. At least for this story.
It is.
Maybe
that movie is going to bomb, too. Nobody wants to see Resident Evil anymore.
Yeah. It's this movie, to me, is kind of like those movies in that I think it's going to be good, but I think I'm just going to wait to rent it versus go to the theater.
Yeah,
because
on Netflix.
I think movie theaters have become kind of weird for me in that there's two reasons I go to movies. One, I'm really hyped. And I'm not super hyped for this one. I went to Star Wars because I'm a Star Wars fan. And I also knew the theater was going to be packed. So, like, any, like, good moments, there's going to be a big crowd reaction. And I like that. Like, that's an experience I'm not going to get at my house. So, like, it's kind of like when you're watching E3 and, like, I'm there in person and something happens, everyone reacts. Like, that's awesome. And that's something that you're not going to get when you rent a movie. And then there's the movies that I go to because I just need to get away, right? I need to get away from life. I need a break. That's usually when I go to, like, a comedy. Like, I went to Office Christmas Party, like, 2 weeks ago. Hilarious movie. Normally a movie I would rent, but I just needed to watch something funny and get away from life. And Assassin's Creed doesn't really hit any of those notches. It hits kind of that movie that I want to watch it, but it's something I'm just going to throw on in the background as I'm doing work at Zelda Informer.
Teach their own.
It's all about what you like. Like, I think I'm going to end up loving this Assassin's Creed movie. Everything I've read about it feels like this is what I want Assassin's Creed to be. But it's like, you know, Alpha just said, you know, a lot of out of animus, like dealing with the animus and all this stuff. Like, that sounds exciting to me. Still not hyped enough to go see it because I think I've just been soured on so many of these kind of movies in the past. I just, like, the last movie I got hyped for was The Prince of Persia. That was video game related. And that was not good.
Let me give a quick shout out to Arrival. If anyone hasn't seen that, I bet you it's in, like, the cheap theaters. Awesome, awesome movie.
Oh, that's such a great
film. Of course, what's going to happen is I'm going to end up watching this Assassin's Creed movie. I'm going to love it. They're going to make a second one. I'm going to be hyped. I'm going to go to it, and it's going to suck.
Well, this has been a good year for movies, and next year looks even better. With
my favorite movie this year is Popstar. Everyone's going to hate me for saying that, but
I heard it was really good.
I still haven't seen
Popstar.
I loved Arrival, by the way. Arrival was the poor man's Interstellar that was better.
It's better than.
Yep,
it's better than,
in my opinion.
I might have to check
say
that
it's
out.
Better than
I would
Interstellar.
Put it on par with Interstellar. It was really clever and really unique. And it was more about how humans interact.
It was kind of had the same idea.
Yeah.
Movie.
Yeah. But yeah. So.
Sure.
Kind of probably have to wrap it up. Right. But. Like we said, there's lots of good movies out. I don't know how we got on the topic, but we did. That always happens on this show, though. We always
2016. We'll see you next year.
Yeah.
Yeah. We won't see 2016 next year. Again. We'll see you guys next year. Yeah. But there's lots to look forward to in 2017. Then our first podcast of the year will be on a Friday next week because we're switching schedules up. To record on a Wednesday and post on a Friday. So if you were like, whoa, there's no podcast today, it's because it's on a Friday now. So that gives us a little bit more time to recap some of the weeks and what happened over the weekend and then just get into it that way. So we hope you guys enjoyed this podcast. We had 4 people on, which we haven't had in a while.
Although,
thank you guys for joining us.
Wait, thank you. Let me look here.
Yeah.
I'm debating.
So,
as we just said, you know, we're going to do it on Friday. I just kept thinking, you know, the Nintendo Switch event's on the 12th? I almost wonder if we should delay that one. Like, because we'd record on a Wednesday and release on a Friday.
Oh, yeah.
I know.
We can always do a
reaction
video.
Yeah, reacts and all that stuff. But, like, I'm just wondering, like, because what are we going to talk about that day but the event, and it's going to already happen by the time people listen to it.
Mm-hmm. That's true. We could record Thursday and I can put it up Friday.
If we could somehow make that work where we already know what happened at the event, at least.
Don't worry about that.
All right, whatever, we'll figure it out. Yeah, we always do. We cross the river.
We'll cross
that
bridge when we get to
it. Monday. All right, catch you guys later.
All right. So, thank you guys for joining us. Have a happy new year, and see you next time.